Hello, how many languages can you speak? One, two, maybe three? Or you could impress us with even more languages, but guess what? Google's new machine translation system can translate between more than 1,000 languages. We bet no one can do that. In this video, we will basically summarize the 57 pages of this paper for you to see what the researchers had to do to collect data for more than 1,000 languages, how they trained their machine translation models, and in which ways they surprised us. So, grab a cup of coffee because it is time to discuss about multilingual transformers in this AI coffee break. But first, let's thank Weights&Biases for sponsoring today's video. Weights&Biases is an MLOps platform helping you and your team improve the process of building and maintaining machine learning models. It helps with experiment tracking, saving model configurations for easy reproduction, hyperparameter search, and many other things. It gets even better because Weights&Biases lives where you work. Stay focused on training models in whichever machine learning library you know and love. Weights&Biases has callbacks or loggers for Keras, PyTorch, Lightning, Hugging Face, YOLO version 5, MM detection, and more. Just pass one line of code to turn on experiment tracking, model checkpointing, and data visualization, and get back to training your models. For example, when using Hugging Face transformers, just set report to 1db in the trainer arguments to turn on logging. If you're a Keras user, just pass the 1db callback to the fit method, and if you're a PyTorch Lightning user, then passing the 1db logger to the trainer will turn on rich logging of your experiment metrics and system performance metrics for free. Go to 1db.me/AI coffee break to find out more about Weights&Biases. Now, back to the video. Today we are talking about machine translation models, like the ones behind Google Translate. As you've maybe already noticed with Google Translate, while for some language pairs like English and German the translation quality is impressive, for rarer language pairs the translation quality can be lower. Although we cannot really demonstrate this for German, Romanian or other language pairs I speak, since the algorithms are probably based on transformer models and have improved their performance quite a lot lately. But the bad news still remains that some languages are not even covered by Google Translate. One reason for this is that it is hard to find enough training data for them. And Google Translate is just an example. The problem that some languages work better than others is well known for machine translation systems, not just for Google Translate. Languages for which you can find a lot of text on the internet, so high-resource languages like English, German, French, Spanish, have high machine translation quality because you know the motto of training neural networks, the more data, the better. But there are lots and lots of low-resource languages for which you can find very little or no data on the World Wide Web. Just so you get an idea, there are more than 7,000 languages spoken in the world today, but machine translation systems have been built for around 100 languages so far, for which the data collection was easy and where there is more economical incentive to cover a language. As the paper points out, we cite, despite high speaker populations, languages spoken in Africa, South and Southeast Asia, and indigenous languages of the Americas are relatively underserved. For example, Google Translate supports Frisian, Maltese, Icelandic and Corsican, each with fewer than 1 million native speakers, but not, up until this work, Bhojpuri, Oromo and so on. So the authors refer to these languages as long-tail languages, since the data scarcity requires the application of machine learning techniques that can generalize beyond the languages for which ample training data is available. So, the idea of this paper is, if we want to go far beyond hundreds of languages to reach the order of magnitude of the thousands, the authors need to crawl a dataset that captures the long tail too. Easy, right? No, it turned out to be much harder than I thought. No wonder this paper is such a long one, describing a lot of the problems that can arise when trying to collect data for low-resource languages. But first, what kind of data are we talking about? The training data of modern neural machine translation systems is a mix of parallel and monolingual data. Parallel data is key for machine translation because it means that for each sentence in a language, we have the same sentence in a different language. Clearly, this data should be the most valuable for learning to translate. But imagine that pairs of sentences in different languages are not as cheap and easy to get as monolingual text where we have sentences just in one language. Researchers at Google, not me, have parallel data for 112 languages, consisting of 25 billion sentence pairs. To get to 1,000 languages, the parallel data strategy cannot scale, at least not for now, and machine translation systems that train on any available parallel data can also train on additional monolingual data. The crazy part is that through back translation and self-training, they learn to translate between languages for which there is no parallel data. But let's not get ahead of us now. Our point here is that to extend machine translation to 1,000 languages, the best bet of the authors is to collect monolingual data of 1,000 languages. Then to train a model on the parallel data they already have, and also on all monolingual sentences, and bam, they can enable machine translation for 1,000 languages. Then great, let's gather some monolingual data for more than 1,000 languages. It should be easy, right? Right? No, it's not. Kreutzer and collaborators show that data gathering strategies that work for high resource languages are gathering way too much noise for low resource languages and therefore cannot be applied in the same way. The problem here is that to gather data for a language, one first needs to identify whether text from the internet is written in that language. To do this at internet level, this language identification should be fast, so using a transformer model is maybe not the best idea. Even worse, after gathering the data, storing it before filtering can be challenging. And this is Google speaking, with a lot of servers and data storage. Oh. Okay, so how did the authors proceed? By starting with the beginning, I guess, which is determining the 1,745 languages the authors would be interested in scraping. This number, of course, is an upper bound of what will come after data gathering and filtering, because it's a little bit too optimistic to think that for all these languages, the crawl text would have high enough quality. The list of 1,745 languages is not containing 83 languages for which the authors already have a lot of data. So they move on by training a simple and lightweight language identification model. It is important for this one to be fast because it will look at enormous amounts of text at virtually the whole internet. This model is a CLD3 model, which is a feed-forward neural network working on text, represented as a bag of characters, basically counting how many times certain character n-grams, so groups of characters, occur in the text. Maybe you wonder why not bag of words, but bag of characters. Well, the authors are working with thousands of languages, where, for a lot of them, it is not straightforward how to split text into words, since not all languages are as benevolent as English, where words are separated by spaces and sentences are separated by clear punctuation signs. With character n-grams, the models can be applied on languages which are harder to tokenize. They train this model on, WeCite, an aggregation of proprietary and publicly available text corpora with an average of 800,000 tokens per language. But surprise, the authors did not use this model to start crawling the dataset just yet, but just to test on which of the 1,745 languages the model performs well enough. Because on some languages, the language classification error of the language identifier is just too high, so they drop these languages, keeping 1,629 of them. On these 1,629 remaining languages, they train another CLD3 model. Why didn't they use the other CLD3 model they just trained on 1,745 languages? We do not know for sure, as the paper is visibly written by many authors and it looks like each single one of them did a part in this pipeline, and when writing it up, they sometimes fail to connect the dots between the different paper sections to motivate some steps properly. We can only think of the obvious reason for retraining another model on just 1,629 languages, because a classification model with less output possibilities has a better chance to not confuse languages. Okay. Great! With this lightweight language identification model, the authors finally crawled the internet to find text in one of these 1,629 languages. And do you think they are done? Not so fast. The problems are just starting because there's a lot of garbage in the scraped text. Like, for example, random sentences of non-linguistic content that is fooling the language identification model into thinking it's one of the languages of interest. So the authors discard sentences whose language does not correspond to the language of the whole document. And they remove the sentences which do not contain enough words that are most frequent for the predicted language. There is even more filtering going on here with clustering of languages, which are varieties of the same language, or more filtering based on token frequency, but there is still some more filtering to do. Now that the raw corpus is already gathered and the data amounts are bounded, the authors use a more sophisticated and slower language identification model to make even better predictions on what the language of each sentence is. Yes, you guessed correctly, this more complex language identifier is transformer-based. After even more filtering with this identifier and sentence deduplication, some languages still needed more filtering with language-specific fixes. For example, there were funny occurrences where in Scottish Gaelic 570 million sentences contain a token, which means download, or Cree that had almost only lorem ipsum sentences. And this was it. It was simple enough to gather the data, right? No, it wasn't at all. And the authors let volunteers, which are native speakers but also non-speakers doing detective work, audit 72 languages to estimate how much usable data the authors ended up with. The median score is 80%, which speaks a bit for the difficulty of the problem of scraping the right data and applying all the right filters for such a large and diverse set of languages. Okay, so now that the dataset more or less stands, the authors are ready to train a machine translation system on it. Not on all of it, but on the part of the languages that have enough data, which is 25,000 sentences before the deduplication step in filtering. Yes, you heard right, before the deduplication, not after. This is again an unmotivated design choice that the paper does not care to explain. So the authors choose 1,057 languages, which have 25,000 sentences before deduplication, add the 83 high-resource languages they already had data for, to set up an impressive set of monolingual data. But wait, there is more, namely the 25 billion sentence pairs of parallel data of translation to and from English for 112 languages. So it's just now that the machine translation systems are ready to train. For the modeling part, there is not really novelty from this paper, which is nothing bad, since the main contribution is the dataset and the engineering work to get models to train on it. So their modeling choices are pretty standard. The model learns to translate the 112 languages with the help of the parallel data that is available, but as a second objective, it is simultaneously trained on the monolingual data, so on the 1057 plus 83 languages, with the mass training objective, which basically means that random spans of text are masked out and the model needs to predict the masked tokens. It's like BERT, but instead of masking individual tokens, here we mask entire groups of words. The idea of the simultaneous training on parallel and monolingual data is that the parallel data teaches the model to translate between around 100 languages. The masked language modeling on monolingual data teaches the model something useful about language in general, so that at the end of training the model is able to not only translate between 100 languages with parallel data, but also do rough translations between English and the rest of the languages. Which comes in handy because now the authors use another established technique in machine translation called self-training, meaning that the model can continue training in a second stage by using the two objectives we know so far, translation and masked language modeling at span level, but also train to translate on sentence translation pairs that previous checkpoints of the model have generated. So here we are with trained models on more than 1,000 languages. There are quite a number of ablations the authors do, but we will focus on two kinds of experiments. The first experiment is comparing a 1.5 billion and a 6 billion parameter model trained on a combination of 112 languages with parallel data and 206 languages with monolingual data. So we're not yet at 1,000 languages here. Unsurprisingly, the more parameters models have, the better they memorize, we mean capture, the diversity of all these languages, at least when it comes to translating into English. But the most interesting part was when the authors compared a model trained on 200 languages with one trained on 1,000 languages. What would we expect here? Well, of course, the model trained with 1,000 languages can translate between more languages, duh. But the surprising part is that adding so many as 1,000 languages, from which most are low resource and noisier in quality, does not interfere with the translation performance of most high resource languages. This is a bit unexpected, because previous work by Zothand and collaborators made us think that adding many low-resource languages in the dataset of monolingual sentences can hurt model performance. The explanation of the authors is not necessarily proven or exact, but they hypothesized that after a certain number of languages, the probability for each added language to be similar to an already existing one increases. In other words, it might seem complex to translate between 1,000 languages if they don't have any similarities. But they do, which explains the observed effect. Unfortunately, this paper does not have a full suite of experiments that gradually increases the number of languages from the hundreds to the thousands to see at what language number this effect starts to appear and whether the improvement is continuous or makes a discontinuous jump. Now, thinking a bit further about this, what would be interesting to know in this highly multilingual regime is whether languages with a lot of resources that were seen more often by the model somehow affect or culturally imprint the low-resource languages. More concretely, we are wondering whether a multilingual model that has seen a lot of English but not so much Romanian would think more in English than in Romanian, introducing English specificities in Romanian translations. But now it's time to conclude this video by noting that the contributions of this paper are great. The thing to be unhappy about is that the release of this paper does not come with a release of the data or of the models. We guess that Google has little incentive to open source the research they base their Google Translate product on. But speaking of open source, look at Meta's response to this paper. They train a 200 language machine translation system and open source it. I guess Google wins at the number of languages, but Meta AI wins at making its research more accessible to a wider public. So what are your thoughts on this? Let us know in the comments, and we hope you learned something today and hope to see you in the next video.